grisly crimes from the past. There has been an accident. They called them the bright young things. In the 1920s, the gilded children of London society pursued gaiety with a special kind of frenzy. The horrors of World War I lay in the past, but the future, few thoughts were spared. Instead, privileged youth grasped feverishly for the here and now, drinking heavily, driving recklessly, and making promiscuous love. They danced to jazz, they held fancy dress ball. Life was a funfair of glittering silliness, and inevitably, it happened that once in a while, somebody fell off a roundabout. Elvira Dolores Barney, 27, belonged to the lost generation, the daughter of Sir John and Lady Mullens. She was a conspicuous figure in society, slender, attractive, and arrogant. A brief marriage to an older man had ended in quarrels and separation. With her own inheritance and a rich allowance from her parents, the young Miss Barney returned to the circuit looking for a good time and a lover. She found him in 24 years old Michael Scott Stephen, one-time dress designer and all-purpose man about town. He was something of a gambler who also sponged off rich women. And when the couple set up home at 21 Williams Mew, Knightsbridge, it was Elvira Barney who paid the bills. The house lay off Loudon Square, and the couple scandalized the neighbors with their noisy parties. They had equally noisy quarrels too, and it was the night of 31st of May, 1932, that one of these proved fatal. Around midnight, Mrs. Barney's doctor received a telephone call. The woman's voice at the other end of the line was near hysterical. "For God's sake, doctor, come at once. There has been a terrible accident." Arriving at the Mews cottage, the doctor found Stephen lying dead in the upstairs bedroom. He had been shot at close range through the chest. Nearby was a .32 Smith & Wesson revolver, in which two of the chambers were empty. "He can't be dead," Mrs. Barney was moaning. "I love him so. Let me die. Let me die. I'll kill myself." That then was the tableau. Mrs. Barney, her dead lover, and the gun. When the police arrived, she was still in a state of distress. A detective asked her to accompany him to the station. She struck him, calling out, "I'll teach you to put me in a cell, you foul swine." Alternately tearful and imperious, Mrs. Barney telephoned her parents, afterwards warning, "Now you know who my mother is. You'll be more careful of what you say." But when her parents arrived, she went quietly to the station. There, she made the same statement that she had made to her doctor. It was a version of events from which she never departed. She said that she and her lover had come back to the Mews cottage half drunk from a party at the Café de Paris. Stephen declared that he was going to leave her, and she had threatened to kill herself if he did so. She took the gun from under a cushion where it had been hidden. He leaped at her to prevent the suicide. In the struggle which followed, Stephen grabbed the revolver, which went off by accident, and killed him. Since Mrs. Barney's was the only evidence then available, she was released from custody. 3 days later, however, she was formally arrested. The police had been making inquiries in the neighborhood. No one could doubt the violent nature of Elvira Barney's romance. 3 weeks before Stephen's death, for example, Mrs. Hall, a resident, had seen him come to the Mews cottage in the early hours of the morning. He was asking for money, but was told by Mrs. Barney to go away. He did so, but came back later that night. He was repulsed again, and on that occasion, Mrs. Barney had looked out of her window, apparently naked, and shouted down, "Laugh, baby, laugh for the last time." Then she had fired a revolver. The same witness declared that on the fateful night, there had been a loud argument in which Mrs. Barney had cried out, "I will shoot you," before the gun was fired. Brought to the trial at the Old Bailey on a murder charge, Elvira Barney found some formidable forensic experts ranged against her. Sir Bernard Spilsbury, the eminent pathologist, testified that there were no smoke or scorch mark on the dead man's clothes or body. These are generally found when a victim was shot at point-blank range. In fact, the angle of the bullet wound implied that Stephen had been shot from a distance of several feet. Moreover, the gunsmith, Robert Churchill, noted that the Smith & Wilson had a very heavy action, its pull amounting to 14 pounds. It was hard to see how it could have been fired by accident. Finally, a mysterious bullet hole had been found in the bedroom wall, but no bullet had been recovered from it. If two shots had been fired, it made the case for an accident appear doubly improbable. Defending Elvira Barney, however, was one of the most brilliant advocates of the day. His name was Sir Patrick Hastings. And although a specialist in civil actions, he brought an outstanding legal mind to bear on the criminal case. Significantly, Mrs. Hall, who had first claimed to hear the words, "I'll shoot you," changed the words at the trial to "I'll shoot." This could well carry the implication that Mrs. Barney was threatening suicide, not murder. Moreover, Hastings had the same witness support the case for a suicidal threat. Discussing the earlier shooting incident, Mrs. Hall agreed that Stephen and Mrs. Barney seemed very friendly on the morning after the "Laugh, baby, laugh" episode. "What conversation passed between you and the young man?" asked Hastings. "I told him to clear off as he's a perfect nuisance in the mews." "What did he reply?" "He apologized and said he didn't want to leave Mrs. Barney because he was afraid that she might kill herself." In fact, Hastings was so content the shots fired by Mrs. Barney 3 weeks before Stephen died was not aimed after him in the mews, it was the shot which accounted for the mysterious bullet holes in the bedroom wall. Mrs. Barney had fired the run in random, hoping to persuade her lover that her suicide threats were genuine. Spilsbury's apparent damning forensic evidence was dismissed as theorizing rather than hard fact, as for Robert Churchill's claim that the gun could not have gone off by accident, Hastings had a dramatic answer. Brandishing the revolver before the court, he pulled the trigger repeatedly at the ceiling. It was a gesture accompanied with the utmost panache, although Hastings is said to have later admitted that the effort made his fingers sore. Mrs. Barney herself made a more than a favorable impression. She spoke in a low, dignified tones, her emotion evident but never outstated. She readily admitted that both her marriage and her affair had been unhappy. A tragic figure in the dock, she seemed more ill-fitted than ill-intentioned. They had made love, she said, on the fateful night, but it had not been successful. He said that he was not pleased with the way things were going, and he wanted to go away the next day and not see me at all. That made me very unhappy. He got up from the bed and dressed. I asked him not to leave me and said that if he did, I should kill myself. Did he say or do anything then? He got up and took the revolver, saying, "Well, you don't do it with this." There followed the struggle and the shot. In his final speech, Hastings meticulously reiterated the thrust of the defense's case. Only Mrs. Barney could say what happened on the night of Stephen's death, and she had never departed from her story. In summing up, the judge paid tribute to the power of Sir Patrick's speech, but left the facts to the jury to interpret. It was a case for excellence for a jury. The best experts available had given the testimony. The best legal minds had presided in court. But when all was said and done, The outcome had to revolve around a human assessment of the case. Did she do it or didn't she? After only 1 hour and 50 minutes, the jury declared that she didn't. Elvira Barney's acquittal was greeted with cheers from a crowd outside the court. A free woman, she went to France to escape the burden of publicity. But it seems that she had not been greatly chastened by the long courtroom ordeal. As chance would have it, Sir Patrick Hastings also crossed the channel after the trial for a holiday with his family. While driving from Boulogne, he narrowly escaped death when a car coming from behind overtook him on the wrong side of the road. The driver of the car was Mrs. Barney. Socialite, beauty, and subject of scandal, Elvira Barney never got a chance to outlive the label of a bright young thing. 4 years after the trial, she was found dead in a Paris hotel bedroom. She was 31 years old. Thank you for watching. If you have enjoyed this story, please like, subscribe, and leave a comment, as it helps with the YouTube algorithm to grow this channel. You will find similar contents in my other videos. Have a safe day. Signing off.